नया शक्ति आयो, नया शक्ति आयो, नया शक्ति आयो।
Inclusive democracy, sustainable growth and social justice. New visions for economic development in Nepal.
Because of you and friends in Oxford and my place living in the UK, I have this opportunity to meet with you and share my humble ideas with you. I am indeed really humbled to be in this great institution which has been ranked as the best university of the world, as Professor Gellner rightly pointed out. In our days, youth, everybody used to dream of getting admitted to Oxford and getting some degree from here. So I also had some such illusions. I didn't have the opportunity to come to the real Oxford, but in our days, people used to call JNU the Oxford of the East. So I happened to get my education there. Now I'm really happy to be in the real Oxford. I would like to believe that today, as I stand here to speak, I speak as a representative voice of all those who want genuine change and a viable alternative in Nepal. These voices are not merely impulsive, but also informed. They are infused with immense determination to translate them into reality. Let me initiate the discussion on alternative vision for Nepal's political system and economic development through my own story. Friends, as I already indicated a while ago, being a politician has never been more difficult, never been more infuriating than at this time of pronounced contradictions and perplexities. However, let me also tell you that this is also the most exciting and testing time for political leadership in a country that has recently promulgated a new constitution after decades of peaceful as well as armed struggle. I, as a 62-year-old man, after years of championing Maoist ideas, I have resolved to start anew. I hope you understand the enormity of the challenge staring in my face. There are certain stances that have remained continuous throughout my political life, and there are things that I have now found important to learn and unlearn today. Since the initial years of my student activism, I had consistently stood for a republic that's free from monarchy and autocracy. I have also consistently struggled against undemocratic tendencies within the Communist Party. And perhaps many of you already know I have had to face many charges and even punished for that. Understanding the nature of underdevelopment of Nepal has not only been of my doctoral research, but making a concerted attempt to change that structure of underdevelopment and poverty has been my lifelong pursuit. For all the mistakes and shortcomings that may have occurred in the process, I must say that I have no regrets whatever in making those attempts. I am here to learn as I act and will continue to do so. One main reason why I left the Maoist Party and to start anew was the realization that a major chapter in the political history of Nepal got completed with the promulgation of the new constitution. We now have to embark upon a new era by taking positive lessons from the previous one and discarding the negative ones. Having completed one significant political course, now is the time to focus on economic development so that we have the capacity and resources to implement the political provision encoded in the constitution. How can a state deliver its promises of making fundamental rights of education, health, shelter, employment realizable to its people if it's economically so poor? As you may know, Nepal's per capita income right now is only $700 per annum. That comes to only $2 per person per day. That means the whole country is below the poverty line. How can political parties claim to have the moral authority to carry out an economic revolution when they themselves are so corrupt and short-sighted? A new era therefore requires new political and economic visions and audacity to break away from a polluted, corrupt political culture. Since the party that I was previously committed showed no signs of breaking itself away from such corrupt and hypocritical tendencies, I decided to take a plunge myself. I left a party that I spent the prime period of my life building, leading, and setting its agenda. It played the most significant role in making Nepal a republic. Nepali people elected their representatives to constituent assembly for the first time in Nepal's history to have their own constitution. Through long drawn and intense round of political debates and deliberations, Nepal now is a federal, democratic, secular, inclusive republic. And yet, I also know that our achievements fell short of expectations of a large mass of our people who wanted us to be more progressive. It was very disappointing and rather embarrassing to witness the main leadership of my previous party discarding and unduly compromising on some of the most fundamental principles. I also felt the need to start anew because I felt that after the promulgation of the constitutions, there was a sense of complacency in the rank and files of not just my party, but in almost all parties. The political leaders were back to their same old business and way of life. Unless the ordinary public feels that politics is serving them, caring for them, and working for them for the betterment of their lives, hard won political cause tends to become irrelevant for the people, especially the youths. I saw this pattern develop rampantly during the last constituency assembly elections. However, there was little realization within the old party for an honest introspection and correction. There was no willingness to bring changes in the working style of the party. There was reluctance to revisit and develop the party's political ideology to make it relevant to the needs of the 21st century. Therefore, I strongly felt that a new political outfit with a new vision and with a new team was absolutely necessary. I consciously decided to avoid the conventional path of splitting an existing party and decided instead to resign from my party all state positions. And today, friends from the Maoist party and a lot of new colleagues like Mr. Madan Rai is here. Please stand. He belongs to no party. He is a renowned agricultural scientist. He never joined any party. People like him and others have come together to build a Naya Shakti. Our aim is to build an alternate political party endowed with principles and goals of sovereignty, economic prosperity, accountability, transparency, sustainability, and inclusive participatory democracy. It shall not only be a political party, but will also be an alternate political path or movement that can adorn Nepali politics with honest and ideal strategies, policies, method, and culture. Dear friends, first let me speak a little about the need to reconceptualize our idea of democracy. The constitution making process in Nepal marked a significant break with political continuity in at least three major ways. First, from monarchy to republic. Secondly, from civil conflict to peaceful politics. And thirdly, from non-inclusive state mechanism to inclusive democracy. The success of the new constitution and its ability to pave the way for a stable and peaceful Nepal in the coming days will depend on our ability to fulfill the latter objectives, that of inclusive democracy. although the new constitution comes with some promising provisions, it is rather unfortunate to note that the outcomes of the second constituent assembly did not faithfully reflect the achievements of the first constituent assembly. Among the most notable achievements that we failed to uphold in the final constitution were the identification of the basis for federal restructuring on 5 criteria of identity and 4 criteria of capability fixed by the first constituent assembly. Additionally, the formation of autonomous states for nationalities with more than 1% of the total population, which would have amounted to 9 to 10 states as agreed upon by the State Restructuration Committee of the first Constituent Assembly and the State Restructuring Committee, was discarded. Many progressive provisions aimed at equal and just treatment of women, Dalits, Muslims, which were finalized in the first Constituent Assembly, were abandoned in the second Constituent Assembly. As a consequence, today we can see right before us our own eyes that in spite of getting a new constitution which codified the concept of inclusive democracy, there are serious dissatisfactions among those who feel left out, particularly the Madhesis, the Tharus and the Adivasi Janjatis. It is in this context that I consider it important to state that inclusive democracy on its own would not yield fair and equal representation. This is because the groups included in state institutions could still be underrepresented. Therefore, it is significant to hyphenate the principle of inclusion with the provision for proportional allocation of political space. Furthermore, even a system of proportional representation would be insufficient to address the task of doing away with the unitary centralized structure of the state. Unless the histories and culture of ethno-lingual regional communities are justly reorganized, recognized, devolution of power alone would not fulfill the aspiration of a large section of the people. Hence, in the Nepalese context, the agenda of federalism is intrinsically associated with the call for inclusive and proportional representative democracy. The current demand for constitutional amendment needs to be viewed in this light. The proposition of proportional, inclusive and participatory democracy in due consideration of the 3 clusters proposed by the Naya Shakti Party may be considered useful in this context. We have evolved this concept of 3 clusters, which means if we look into the composition of Nepalese society, the population distribution of 3 broad clustered communities can be broadly identified as those of Khas Aryas being 1/3, Madhesi Tharus as being 1/3, and Adivasi Janjati as being the other 1/3 of our total population. Although the new constitution has resolved many issues, the basic contradictions between the distribution of rights among these 3 clusters have remained unresolved. Let me share with you that when I completed my undergrad in architecture, I was 23 years. My family members wanted me to set up my own architecture firm, but I couldn't reconcile with the idea of simply helping myself when millions of people in my country could not even feed themselves adequately. I decided to study books that would help me understand poverty and underdevelopment better and find a solution to the same. I pursued my master's and PhD with the same intent. Quite obviously and readily, I got attracted to socialist and communist ideas, principles and figures. I started organizing the place, working and studying in India, and I became deeply involved in domestic politics thereon. I was at the forefront of an armed revolution in my 40s. Today, when I stand in front of you, I cannot but remember the faces of hundreds of friends that I lost on the way. they were rigorously concerned and devoted towards our country and its people. More than perhaps you and I are today. I of course regret the death of every single Nepali during political movements or while pursuing public cause. And yet, I can never agree that sovereign people of any country do not have a legal and moral right to resist and fight an oppressive state system. State and the governments that run it are subservient to the people. They always will be. Nepali people in general have been living a tough life. People of my generation began their adulthood in a very controlled polity, when we could not even freely express our political dissent against an autocratic rule. Yet we fought against oppressive regimes in the past. We brought some major transformative moments in history, but we also have our own share of failures and disappointments. I know many of you are not happy with the leaders of my generation. That includes me too. However, I think it makes a difference if we are willing to honestly learn from our past experiences, acknowledge our failures, and make relentless efforts towards making it easier and better for all Nepalese. Whatever our contribution and qualifications in the past, I humbly accept that my abilities and the combined abilities of our generation are no longer enough. Nepal now needs to borrow your abilities, the abilities of the younger generation. I truly believe that your abilities are superior to those of the people of my generation. It is your generation that inspires and motivates me to want to become new and envision better alternatives for our country. All our efforts are for your generation. And now you have to take the lead. I am here merely to facilitate and assist as long as I can and as long as you want. My capacity will always be committed towards creating better conditions in Nepal to facilitate our youth to live and work in their own country, especially the youth like you who are in foreign lands and do not find enough incentive and motivation to return to Nepal. When I was young, I too had a choice to just criticize the existing system and do nothing personally or collectively about changing. But I didn't take that choice. I couldn't remain a mute witness even while I was studying in India. I set out with firm conviction to fight against the ills of Nepalese society, primarily against the autocratic regimes and acute poverty and unemployment. Anyone who has done anything substantive in their lives knows that when you try to do something, you may not be right all the time. You may not even succeed all the time. And yet, we can sit idle doing nothing, just fearing something would go wrong or that you have lost one particular battle. The same choice is with many of you in this audience, the young generation of today. I appeal to you to come forward and take a leap, small or big. Take up any task that helps your country and its people. Let's work together, making Nepal prosperous in our own way.
I guess I'm not the only one who would believe that the economic and social promises that each one of these political ideologies puts forward haven't been fulfilled. So I was wondering if you would see why, in the context of Nepal, is there any specific with Nepal as a country in general, reasons why these ideologies did not work? I mean, we elected the Maoist government, we had the multi-party democracy in 1990. So that was my first question as to why it did not work.
You've got ration people to one to start with, and you can come back later if you want a second one.
Thank you.
My simple answer, why we couldn't embark on the path of economic development was political revolution was delayed. We have just partial revolution, you see. You can say, sometimes I jokingly say, it's a halal revolution. You see. So we have never completed. So this is one of the reasons. Now I think this is the time, if we amend the constitution and meet the demands of the Madhisis and Janjatis, and then focus with new political understanding, which Naya Shakti Nepal is trying to promote, then next several decades, I think we should be able to have a economic development in the country.
The southern border constantly demoralizing the national interest of the country, in the interest of Indian interest, and being yourself the finance minister and prime minister and seeing all of this, how do you think you sort of create a policy to tackle that, to go in the same direction that China and India and bring in economic growth?
Federal restructuring of the state. I said that's the only solution, there is no other solution. And secondly, how to manage India and China. For this we have proposed Nepal as going beyond the old concept of Nepal, we say dui dhanga ko bich ko tarun, that the yam between two big boulders, India and China are big boulders, and Nepal is in between as a yam. So we have to go beyond that. Now the things have changed in the 21st century. So India, China has become a big ocean of economic prosperity, and India is also becoming another ocean of economic prosperity. So why not Nepal develop as a bridge between these two huge big markets? And develop as a vibrant bridge between the two. That will be to the advantage of Nepal. We could take advantage of big markets on both sides, and we can preserve our sovereignty as well as develop ourselves. I think that is the only way we can develop. The
question is, how are you going to manage that one third who are very powerful? How are you going to persuade them?
So what I have been providing myself, I belong to the Khasari community. So all the Khasariyas should not be clubbed together as anti-federalist. So what happens in every revolution is a section of the ruling nationality and ruling class breaks away and sides with the progressive forces. Then only the revolution gets completed, you see. So that's why this idea of three clusters has been floated by the Naya Shakti party. Only the Madhisis and Janjatis won't be able to win this battle. For this, a section of the Khasariyas like me should join in of the Madhisi Janjatis and the Tharus to win this battle.
When you say you are moving away from all that ideology, are you also not betraying the lives of those people who sacrificed their lives, men and women?
I think this was a peculiar form of democratic revolution in Nepal, which has been completed. This is our contention. So in the next phase, to go beyond that, to usher in a rapid development of productive forces and create a basis for socialist transformation, we need to go beyond the old binary of capitalism and socialism, or the old ideological limitations, and find a new political and ideological basis. That's why we have created this Naya Shakti. So it is after completion of this revolution, you see, we have not abandoned the revolution in between. So that is the difference. Whereas the Maoists in India have been fighting for socialism and communism. Because after getting the parliamentary democracy, their rebellion is against the parliamentary democratic system. So there is fundamentally difference there. And why we had to do compromise and join the peace process, there is another dimension which I think we can do later on. That is geopolitical compulsion of Nepal, which doesn't apply to India. It applies to Nepal, you see. That's why we couldn't complete even this political change in one go. So this is one part. Other is whether I have betrayed or we have not betrayed. What we had promised, we have delivered, you see. If you have promised something else and then abandoned in between, it would have been betrayed. But if you go see the 40-point demands, this is exactly what we promised, we delivered, and the now remaining part is the development, economic dividend of political revolution, For that, the new political force or Naya Shakti is still striving for. Thank you.
We should not recruit Gurkhas. We should not let Gurkhas to recruit. I'm surprised there are lots of Gurkha soldiers and army soldiers following your Naya Shakti. So those were the points you had demanded, and these points haven't been addressed during all the regime. And it has been 10 years after you came into peace process. There was 6 years after the evolution of Panchayat Vyavastha, and there has been 10 years. And now Biplab is going to wage a war. That's what he claims to do. In what way should I not follow Biplab for the way I followed you 20 years ago? So what has been changed in yourself that I should follow you now and not Biplab?
We first develop ourselves, be interdependent, then unite the country, whole people on the basis of federalism. Then at a certain stage, if you have to come out of the clutches of foreign domination, then we apply other strategy in the future. So we have changed our strategy and tactics, but we have not abandoned our core demands. This is one aspect I like to say. Why not join Biplab? I think Biplab, I sympathize with him. He's an honest person, but the path he's following is wrong right now. It's not possible. That time, if I had not targeted monarchy, we would also have failed. If we had raised the issue, made socialism and communism as a core demand, then whole country would have united, all the international community would have united against us, and we would have been wiped out, like the whole the Maoist movement in Peru and other countries, we totally wiped out, you see. So that's why we entered into compromise, we preserved the gain of the moment, and we changed the track, then in the later phase, we can fulfill other demand, but Biplab is just following mechanically the old path, which you won't be able to complete. I am sorry, he will sooner or later will have to change his path.
But you are doing a
profession for Biplab. No, I'm not professing. No, I wish the best of luck for him. But the whole thing, in politics, is the power balance that matter.
And how do you politically overcome those? Because it's, you know, they are there, and it's not just because you create one party or another party that you immediately overcome these divisions.
I think inclusive and participatory democracy involves all, ensure the participation of all the sections of the people. About the religious identity part, I think this should be dissociated from politics. Very wrongly in different countries, religion has been dragged into politics. So that's why in Nepal we have gone for a secular state. The religion is the sphere of the individual. So it's been mixed up with politics and the state system. So that's why despite a Hindu majority country, we have gone for secularism.
And how are you going to facilitate those things? Is there any clear vision on, I mean, not only asking people who are abroad, but also not letting those trying to create an environment or something who are in Nepal and not letting them go out? What's the plan you have from your own, I mean, the new party, I mean, the Nasak party?
And our youths who have migrated to foreign countries, we are asking them to return home, and you can make investment, start your own business, and with the government, whether we are in government or not, we'll try to facilitate it. And we believe with this agenda of the party, we'll gain popularity, and in the coming elections, we'll be in a position to lead the country and implement our roadmap of economic development. Before that, why I'm appealing to the youth is, now the time has changed. You needn't be totally disillusioned with the politics of Nepal. The political track has changed. Be optimistic, try to come back to your country, and try to be a part of this new economic revolution.
A very simple question. What is your interpretation? Because you mentioned so many times Maoism. So what's your interpretation of Maoism?
So Marx has said, philosophical thinkers say so many things, you see. But you have to pick up which applies to you, which suits you, you see. For us, what suited us was Mao led a peasant revolution against the Japanese invaders and Chiang Kai-shek in China in the 40s. You see? So in Nepal also, we have to wage a war against monarchy, we have to unite the peasantry, and that Mao's tactics of protective people's war was suited for Nepal. Being a mountainous country, with a peasant country, Mao's tactics of waging people's war was useful for us. That part of Maoism we applied in Nepal. The other part of Maoism, like the cultural revolution, may not suit for now. That's why we have abandoned it now, you see. You abandoned in China, we have also abandoned that part of Maoism. But the earlier part of Maoism, you applied in China in the 40s, we applied in the 90s. So you don't have, you can't apply everything, you see. You have to choose what suits you.
And you are saying, we will be saying the things and we will be doing the same thing. And what the world is bringing now, like Donald Trump says so many propaganda to win the election, and as soon as he won, he make a U-turn. And he started to accept Udo Obama's agenda.
So in my whole life, I have devoted, I have worked honestly, and whatever I have said, I have tried to do it. First, my mission was to abolish monarchy, complete the democratic revolution. For first 4 years of my life, I devoted for it and I achieved that goal. And next goal I have set for myself is to make Nepal prosperous, that means at least take to a middle level income within the next 15 years. So that is achievable goal, and I am striving for that. So you just wait and see. And given the, my past history, Bhavaram Bhattra has never betrayed anybody, and he won't betray.
If this party is going to fail in future, will Bhavaram Bhattra, who has dismantled the arms, to join again and get arms back in his hand?
I didn't get it. This
will you take up arms again?
If the party fails subsequently, will Bhavaram Bhattra take the arms again, which has been done for the last 9 years?
No, it depends on the mission. So for that time I had to wage arms to fight against the monarchy. King has a monopoly over the army. I understand you. That time my mission was to abolish monarchy, to snatch his arms and hand over to the people. But this time my mission is to bring out economic development. You don't bring out economic development through armed struggle. In history, country had developed through armed struggle. So there is no question of my resorting to armed struggle. It depends on the agenda. Now my new agenda is economic prosperity. For that, I have to mobilize the masses of the people, unite the country, and then take them into a mission of economic development. So there is no need. There is no need of raising arms. See, that will be foolish. Utter foolish and unnecessary.
Thank you very much. Naya Sakti Ayo, Naya Sakti Ayo, Naya Sakti Ayo, Naya Sakti Ayo.
सुनको दिन उदायो हेरा सुनको दिन उदायो
सुनको दिन उदायो हेरा सुनको दिन उदायो
सारा जगले समृद्धि को गीत सुरीलो गायो।